Hello everyone, I am Himanshu Vasnani from Department of Mechanical Engineering. I am here to discuss on the subject non-destructive evaluation and testing. The subject code is ME419, unit number 3, lecture 15 in the series. The topic name for today are ultrasonic testing, that is their working principle and procedure, and equipments for ultrasonic testing. So let's start with the lecture. Now today's learning objective are to provide the students with a basic understanding of ultrasonic testing, their working principle and procedure, and to know about equipments for ultrasonic testing. Our learning outcome will be the students will have an understanding of ultrasonic testing, their working principle and procedure. The student will understand various equipments used for ultrasonic testing. So, what is ultrasonic testing? It is also a kind of a non-destructive technique that is used to find out the defects or the discontinuities in the work. We have studied about liquid penetrating testing that was used to find defects on the surface. Then we study about radiographic testing, which was used to study the inner defects, find out the inner defects or discontinuities. It may be in the weldments or maybe in the casting. So radiographic testing was a more bit helpful, but the major problem was it was using gamma rays and x-rays, which needs care, handling care. Okay, we should be careful while handling those x-rays or gamma rays. So now we'll come up one more technique called as ultrasonic testing. It is also a kind of a non-destructive technique. So ultrasonic testing, it is a family of non-destructive testing testing technique based in the propagation of ultrasonic waves in the object or material tested. Okay, there are waves that travel to the object, and if any defect comes, they reflect back. So based on that principle, the materials get tested for any kind of defect. In most common ultrasonic testing application, UT stands for ultrasonic testing. Very short ultrasonic pulse wave with center frequencies ranging from 0.1 to 15 megahertz and occasionally up to 50 hertz are transmitted into the material to detect internal flaws or to characterize material. So in this way, they detect the internal flaws in the material. A common example is ultrasonic thickness measurement, which tests the thickness of the test object, for example, to monitor pipe work corrosion. So in this way, it is helpful to test the thickness of the workpiece, that is of the pipe that is used. Why it has done that? To monitor that if some corrosion has happened, so they can find out. So in this way, they monitor the pipe work corrosion by measuring the thickness. Okay. So you understood, you get a short idea of what is about ultrasonic testing. So ultrasonic testing is often performed on steel and other metals and alloys, although it can be used on concrete, wood and composite with less resolution. It is used in many industries including steel and aluminium construction, metallurgy, manufacturing, aerospace, automotive and other transportation sectors. So you can see that UT, ultrasonic testing, has wide applications. Okay, it is used in manufacturing industry to an extreme limit, in aerospace also, in automotive as usual, in transportation sectors, in metallurgical field, in construction. Okay, so you can see that the amount of applications, the variety of applications this testing technique has. Okay, although it can be also used on concrete, wood and composite also. So ultrasonic testing uses high frequency sound waves, typically in the range between 0.5 to 50 megahertz, to conduct examinations and make measurements. So besides its wide use in engineering applications such as flaw detection, evaluation, that is the main purpose of this kind of testing. Dimensional measurement is an add-on in this UT, ultrasonic testing. Material characterization. Ultrasonics are also used in the medical field, such as sonography, therapeutic ultrasound. So apart from just engineering applications like flaw detection or evaluation, which is the basic funda, and the dimensional measurement, this ultrasonic testing has also its application in the medical field also. So in general, ultrasonic testing is based on the capture and quantification of either the reflected waves, pulse echo, or the transmitted waves through transmission. Okay, what happens in this? It is based on the capture and quantification of either the reflected waves that are coming back or the transmitted waves. Okay, that is a transmitted to someone. So each of the two types is used in certain applications. There are certain applications which in each of the two types are used. But generally, the pulse ecosystem, the reflected wave system are more useful, since they require one side access to the object being inspected. So out of the two, that is reflected waves and transmitted waves, the reflected waves pulse ecosystem is more useful because it gives you one side access to the object being inspected. Okay, so this is helpful. Now, this is just a diagram which is showing you the basic principle of ultrasonic testing. We have studied a lot about here, just a basic idea of what is about ultrasonic testing and what all applications that it can have, and what are the, you can say, different types of, basic types of ultrasonic testing techniques, and which is more helpful, like pulse ecosystem. So in this diagram is showing you the how, what is the basic principle of ultrasonic testing. So you can see on the right hand side there is a transducer, okay, and on under which there are some, you can see the waves are going, and one wave is you can say an interface with a crack, and the other is with the surface, with the bottom surface. So both are reflected back. Then you have a pulsar or receiver there, and then on the left hand side, on the center of the diagram, you can see there is a waveform going. So there's an initial phase, then the crack echo, then the back surface echo. So you can see the crack echo has a very, is very small, and the back surface echo has a comparable better height. So you can see that how this ultrasound testing works. The inspector that is inspecting the things with the help of such kinds of the inspector, which is inspecting these which is using this technique for inspecting the material, they should have some knowledge about how to read these kind of pulses. Now, basic principles of ultrasonic testing. A typical pulse ultrasonic pulse echo ultrasonic inspection system consists of several functional units, such as the pulsar, receiver, transducer, and a display device. You can see all these three things in the right hand side on the diagram. Okay, that there is a pulsar and receiver, and there is a transducer, and there is a display device that is shown. Now, a pulsar oblique receiver is an electronic device that can produce high voltage electrical pulse. Okay, this is a device that is producing high voltage electric pulse. Now, driven by the pulsar, the transducer generates high frequency ultrasonic energy. Now, the pulsar is driving the transducer. Okay, the transducer is generating high frequency ultrasonic energy. The sound energy is introduced. Okay, now the sound energy is introduced and propagates through the material in the form of waves. You can see in the right hand side of the diagram, there are waves that are, you can say, flowing, or you can say propagating through the workpiece or the material. Okay, so how this pulsar is, what pulsar is doing, it is, okay, producing high voltage pulses, and then the transducer generating high frequency ultrasonic energy, and then how the sound energy is propagating through the material in waveform. So when there is a discontinuity, okay, you can see in the diagram there is a crack written in the workpiece. So when there is a discontinuity, such as a crack in the wave path, the part of the energy will be reflected back from the flaw surface. We have seen that the waveform that is coming from the transducer, just as the crack is faced by it, or you can say crack comes in between, the waveform, the it is reflected back from the, you can say, crack surface, or the, you can say, the flaw surface. Okay, the crack surface or the flaw surface. Now the reflected wave signal is introduced, sorry, is transformed into an electric signal. This reflected wave, okay, after the after facing the discontinuity, this reflected wave signal is introduced into an electric signal by the transducer and is displayed on a screen. You can see this signal on the screen in the diagram, which is showing a crack echo. Okay, so in this way, the reflected wave, okay, from the crack, it is transformed into an electric signal by this transducer only, and it is displayed on the screen. Okay, the inspector can see this, or can say, this wave signal and interpret that there is some kind of discontinuity in the workpiece. Now, knowing the velocity of the wave, travel time can be directly related to the distance that the signal traveled. Okay, if you know the velocity of the wave, that travel time can be directly related to the distance that the signal has traveled. See, from this signal, information about the reflector location, size, orientation, and other features can sometimes be gained. Now you can see this diagram. Okay, this shows the working of ultrasonic testing. So how there is a transducer, okay, then there is a test piece or work piece on the bottom, and you can see the arrows through which these sound waves are written, and these acoustic lens, then there is an imaging array. So we'll study about this working of ultrasonic testing in the coming, you can say, slides. Okay, so let's start. In ultrasonic testing, how it works, we are studying. So in ultrasonic testing, an ultrasound, okay, transducer connected to a diagnostic machine. Now there are some words which are, you can say, practical in the industry. So in ultrasonic testing, an ultrasound transducer, okay, is connected. You can see the transducer on the right hand side in the diagram, connected to a diagnostic machine, is passed over the object being inspected. Okay, connected to a diagnostic machine, is passed over to the object being inspected. The transducer is typically separated from the test object by a couplant. The couplant is separating the transducer from the test object. Okay, now example of couplant, like such as oil or by water, as in immersion testing. I'll teach you later immersion testing what is all about. So however, when ultrasonic testing is conducted with an electromagnetic acoustic transducer, the use of couplant is not required. Okay, now there is another term that is used in between, that is known as couplant. It can be a water or an oil. So it is responsible for separating the transducer with the test object. Okay, now here you can see in the further that there are two methods of receiving waveform. The first one is reflection. The second is attenuation. Attenuation. In reflection, or you can see the pulse echo method that we just read in the starting slides, the transducer performs both sending and receiving of the pulsed waves as the sound is reflected back to the device. I repeat, reflection. Okay, pulse echo mode. As the name says, what happens, the transducer, it performs the function of sending and receiving the pulsed waves. How? The transducer performs both the sending and receiving of the pulsed waves as the sound is reflected back to the device. So reflected ultrasound comes from an interface such as back wall of the object, or from an imperfection within the object. This imperfection is the discontinuity. Okay, what happens in pulse echo mode or reflection mode, the transducer, it is performing both the function. It is sending and receiving of the pulse waves as the sound is converted back from the device. Now, if some kind of back wall is there, you can see the signal waveform. And if an imperfection will come, then also you can see the signal waveform. So in this way, reflection mode works. Okay. The diagnostic machine displays these results in the form of a signal. The diagnostic machine, okay, displays these results, these waveform, in the form of a signal with an amplitude representing the intensity of the reflection and the distance representing the arrival time of the reflection. Okay, now you can see the factors. With an amplitude representing the intensity of the reflection and the distance representing the arrival time of that reflection. So in attenuation or through transmission, okay, now the second mode, a transmitter sends ultrasound through one surface and a separate receiver detects the amount that has reached it on another surface after traveling through a medium. Understood how it's working? In attenuation or through transmission mode, a transmitter sends ultrasound through one surface. Now it is sending the ultrasound through one surface, and there is a receiver, and a separate receiver detects the amount that has reached it on another surface. There is another surface that is acting as a receiver, okay, after traveling through the medium. So in the first one, in reflection mode, what happens? The transducer is sending and receiving the signals, whereas in attenuation mode, the transmitter is sending and there is a separate receiver. Okay, so this is called a transmission mode. Now, imperfections or other conditions in the space between the transmitter and the receiver reduce the amount of sound transmitted. I repeat, any imperfection, now this is a discontinuity or a defect or a crack, whatever, or the condition in the space between the transmitter and the receiver. Now this is about which mode? Transmission mode. Okay, the attenuation mode. Now space between the transmitter and the receiver reduce the amount of sound transmitted, thus revealing their presence. Now using the couplant increases the efficiency of the process by reducing the losses in the ultrasonic wave energy due to separation between the surfaces. Using the couplant that is used with the transducer, okay, increases the efficiency of the process by reducing the losses in ultrasonic wave energy due to separation between the surfaces. The surfaces are separated with the help of couplant. Okay, now principle of wave propagation. Now, ultrasonic testing is based on the vibration in materials, which is generally referred to as acoustics. All the material substances are comprised of atoms which may be forced into vibrational motion about their equilibrium positions. Right? Different patterns of vibration motion exist at the atomic level. However, most are irrelevant to acoustic and ultrasonic testing. There are many different patterns of vibration motion exist at the atomic level only, but most are irrelevant to acoustic and ultrasonic testing. So acoustic is focused on particles that contain many items that move in harmony to produce a mechanical wave. When a material is not stressed in tension or compression beyond its elastic limit, its individual particles perform elastic oscillations. Okay, in acoustics, the atoms move in harmony and then they produce a mechanical wave. If the material is not stressed, maybe you can say you have you have is in tension or in compression, okay, if there is a particular elastic limit, if it is under that, then these particles, they perform elastic oscillations. Okay, now when the particles of a medium are displaced from their equilibrium position, internal restoration force arises. When the particles of a medium are displaced from their equilibrium positions, internal restoration force arises. Okay, these elastic restoring forces, now due to the oscillation, it will develop elastic restoration forces between the particles combined with inertia of the particles, they lead to oscillatory motions of the medium. I repeat, these elastic restoring forces between particles combined with inertia of the particles lead to oscillatory motion of the medium. Now in solids, sound waves can propagate in four principal modes that are based on the way the particles oscillate. Now sound can propagate, these four modes they are telling you, that sound can propagate as longitudinal wave, as shear wave, as surface wave, and in thin materials as plate wave. I repeat, the sound can propagate, this can propagate as longitudinal waves, shear waves, surface waves, and thin material as plate waves. The longitudinal and shear waves are the two modes of propagation most widely used in ultrasonic testing. So for UT, ultrasonic testing, two modes of propagation, that is longitudinal and shear waves, these are most widely used. So let's go with them. Now longitudinal waves. Okay, you can see in the diagram the particles motioning. Okay, the particle motion is there, and then there is a wave travel. Okay, so you can understand with the help of diagram only how the longitudinal waves should go. The oscillations occur in the longitudinal direction or the direction of the wave propagation. Okay, the oscillations in this, they occur in the longitudinal direction or the direction of the wave propagation. So since compression and expansion forces are active in these waves, they are also called pressure or compression waves. I repeat, since compression and expansion forces are active in these waves, they are also called pressure or compression waves. Okay, they are also sometimes called density waves because material density fluctuates as the wave moves. The material density fluctuates as the wave moves, so it is sometimes called as density waves. These are compression waves, these are generated in gases, in liquids, as well as solids. Okay, the three mediums, it is in gases also, liquids also. Gases, liquids, both, plus as well as in solids, because the energy travels through the atomic structure by series of compressions and expansion. This energy, they travel through the atomic structure by a series of compression expansion movements. So this is again the diagram showing the longitudinal direction of wave propagation. Okay, so this can give you a slight idea. Now the transverse or the shear waves. So you can see in the diagram on the right hand side, the wave travel is, you can say, comparatively same. You can see in this diagram also, the wave travel is there. But the particle motion, when you compare the longitudinal direction of wave propagation, this, as you can see in this diagram, longitudinal direction of wave propagation, and in the next diagram, you can see the particle motion in the shear wave. You can see the difference. Okay. Here in this, you can see the direction of particle motion and in under in this shear wave you can see the particles motion. So you can see the difference. So in this, particles oscillate at a right angle or transverse to the direction of propagation. In shear waves, what happens? The particles oscillate at right angle or transverse to the direction of propagation. The shear waves, they require an acoustic solid material for effectively propagation and therefore are not effectively propagated in materials such as liquids or gases. They are used in acoustically solid material and these are not effectively propagated in materials such as liquid or gases. The longitudinal waves were in all the three mediums, but shear waves are more in solid material, okay, and not effective in liquids or gases. The shear waves are relatively weak when compared to longitudinal waves. You can see the applications, no? So shear waves are relatively weak when compared to longitudinal waves. So in fact, shear waves are usually generated in materials with some of the energy from longitudinal waves. So these are generated with materials using some of the energy from these longitudinal waves. You can see the diagram again of this shear waves. Okay, you can, it is said that if they oscillate at right angle or transverse to the direction of propagation. So you can see you have a good idea of these kind of waves. Now, modes of sound wave propagation. So in air, sound travel by the compression and rarefaction of air molecules in the direction of travel. In air, this sound travel by the compression and rarefaction of the molecules in the direction of travel. However, in solids, molecules can support vibration in other directions. Hence, a number of different types of solid waves are possible. Waves, you can say sort of waves are characterized by oscillatory pattern that are capable of maintaining their shape and propagating in a stable manner. These waves that we are discussing, these waves can be characterized by oscillatory patterns that are capable of maintaining their shape and propagation in a stable manner. So the propagation of waves is often described in terms of what are called as wave modes. Okay, you can describe the propagation of waves and they are described as wave modes. Okay, now the sound waves that propagate due to vibration or oscillatory motion within the material. So an ultrasonic wave may be visualized as an infinite number of oscillatory masses or particles connected by means of elastic springs. Okay, it can be visualized in this way also. Each individual particle is influenced by the motion of its neighbor, and both inertial and elastic restoring forces act upon each article. Each particle, it is influenced by the motion of the nearest neighbor, and both inertial, okay, by the motion of nearest neighbor, neighbor is important, and both inertial and elastic restoring forces that act upon each particle. Like you can say that they have a mass on a spring as a single resonant frequency, that is natural frequency, determined by its spring constant K and its mass M. So within the elastic limits of any material, there is a linear relationship between the displacement of a particle and the force attempting to restore the particle to its equilibrium position. There has a relationship between the displacement of the particle. Okay. Now this linear dependency is given by Hooke's law. So when you talk about spring model, that is, which has a spring constant K and mass M. Okay. So in terms of spring model, the relationship between force and displacement, okay, is written as F is equals to K into X. K is the spring constant, okay, and the displacement is X. X is the displacement. This is the relationship between force and the displacement. Now, attenuation of sound wave. When sound waves travel through a medium, its intensity diminishes with distance. Okay, when they travel in the medium, the intensity of the sound waves diminishes, becomes less with time, with distance. So in idealized materials, sound pressure, that is the signal amplitude, is reduced to the spreading of wave. Okay, this sound pressure is reduced to the spreading of. So in natural materials, however, the sound amplitude is further weakened due to scattering and absorption. See, there are two things. One is idealized material, one is practical material. So we talk about idealized material, sound pressure, they reduce due to spreading of the waves. Okay, but we have to study about the practical waves. So here we go with the scattering. Scattering is the reflection of the sound in directions other than its original direction of propagation. What happens in scattering? In scattering, what happens? There is a reflection of the sound in direction other than its original direction of propagation. Then absorption. Okay, now absorption is the conversion of the sound energy to other forms of energy. It is converting the sound energy to other forms of energy. The combined effect of this previous term, scattering, and the current term, absorption, is called attenuation. You can see the attenuation has two branches, scattering and absorption. So scattering is the reflection of the sound in directions after other than its original direction of propagation. So scattering is this effect plus absorption, the conversion of sound energy to other forms of energy. So it is combined effect is called as attenuation. So attenuation is generally proportional to the square of the sound frequency. So you can see in the scattering, it is very, you can say this is the reflection of the sound in direction other than its original direction of propagation. So it is leaving its original direction. So see how you can say the inspector has to determine. Now the amplitude change of a decaying plane wave can be say K is equal to A naught E, this is the power minus A naught. Where A naught is unattenuated amplitude, alpha is and the attenuation coefficient, and Z is the distance traveled or travel distance. So ultrasonic equipment. We have various kinds of equipments in ultrasonic testing. So now we're going with those equipment, because equipment are a very important part of the process. If there is no equipment, the test could not be performed. So the equipments are the basic items. So now we'll study about the basic equipments. Like equipment for ultrasonic testing is very diversified. Okay, so proper selection is important to ensure accurate inspection data as desired for specific application. So in general, there are following basic components that compromise an ultrasonic test system, like one, the transducer, then B, it's coupland, then C, it's pulsar and or receiver, and D is calibration standard. So these basic components should be learned and should be understood, all these terms or all these components one by one in the coming slides. Now comes the transducer. Transducer, as on discussion with you in our previous slides, then you can see the transducer has roles in both kinds of, you can say, system of you can say inspection, like you can say reflected waveform and then transmission waveform. In both things it has its application. So let's start with the transducer. That an ultrasonic transducer is a device that converts electrical energy, mechanical energy in the form of sound and mechanical energy back into the electrical energy. Now see the importance of transducer. It's saying that a transducer is a device that converts electrical energy in mechanical energy in the form of sound and mechanical energy back to the electrical energy. So a transducer are manufactured in a variety of forms or shapes and size for varying applications. The conversion of you can say electrical pulse to mechanical vibration and the conversion of returned mechanical vibrations back to the electrical energy is the basis for ultrasonic testing. I repeat, and this is one of the important thing that important basis that the conversion of electrical pulses to mechanical vibration and the conversion of returned mechanical vibrations back into the electric signal is the basis of ultrasonic testing. So see how it has been designed and the process of the transducer has been thought of. Okay, this conversion is done by a transducer using a piece of piezoelectric material or a polarized, you can say, material having some parts of the molecule positively charged while other parts of the molecule are negatively charged with electrodes attached to two of its opposite ends. So when an electric field is applied across the material, the polarized molecules will align themselves with electric field, causing the material to change dimension. This is how the transducer this work. In addition, the permanently polarized materials such as quartz or barium titanium. You can see a permanent polarized material such as quartz or barium titanate will produce an electric field when the material changes dimensions as a result of an imposed mechanical force. Now this phenomenon, okay, when the material changes dimensions as a result of imposed mechanical force, this phenomenon is known as piezoelectric field. The active element of most acoustic transducer and used today is a piezoelectric ceramic which can be cut in various ways to produce different waveforms. A large piezoelectric ceramic element can be seen in the image of section low frequency transducer. The most commonly employed ceramic for making transducer is lead zirconate titanium. Okay, now this you should know that the commonly used employed ceramic for making transducer is lead zirconate titanium. The thickness of the active element is determined by the desired frequency of the transducer. A thin wafer element vibrates within a wavelength that is twice its thickness. Okay, that is twice its thickness. So therefore, piezoelectric crystals are cut to a thickness that is half the desired radiated wavelength. So in this way, you can find out the thickness of an active element by the desired frequency of the transducer. Okay. The higher the frequency of the transducer, the thinner the active element. Ultrasonic transducers are manufactured for a variety of applications that I just came with you. Okay. And can be custom manufactured, or you can say fabricated. It can be custom fabricated when necessary. The careful attention must be paid to selecting the proper transducer for the applications. Now this line holds importance, that there should be careful attention must be paid to selecting the proper transducers for the, you can say, for the application. Now it is important to choose transducers that have the desired frequency or bandwidth and focusing to optimize inspection capability. Most often the transducer is chosen either to enhance the sensitivity or resolution of the system. the transducer, it should have the desired frequency, the bandwidth and focusing for what? To optimize the inspection. Okay, so we should know about all these features. Now these transducers that we see, these are categorized in a number of ways. Okay, the number of ways we shall discuss ways like first contact transducers. Now these contact transducers are used for direct contact inspections and are generally hand manipulated. You can move these transducers with the help of hand, either with kind of some arrangement or hand. They have elements protected in a rugged casing to withstand sliding contact with the variety of materials. You can see how prepared and you can say friendly usable this contact transducer is. So it can withstand sliding contact also. It has a very good casing. Okay. These transducers have an ergonomic design so that they are easy to grip and move along a surface. They often have replaceable wear plates to lengthen their useful life. Okay. Coupling materials of water, grease, oils, and other materials are used to remove the air gap between the transducer and the component being inspected. Okay, in this way, you have said about couplant. So here I'm saying that there are coupling materials of water, like grease or oil or other commercial materials, they are used to remove the air gap. Okay, between the transducer and the component being inspected. So contact transducers are very, you can say, easy to grip. They are, you can say, can be easily moved with the help of hand also. So these are, you can say, these are easy to use. Okay, and they can have a very useful life. You can see in the diagram also. Now immersion transducers. So these transducers, they do not contact the component. As you can see in the diagram also, these transducers, they do not contact the component. These transducers are designed to operate in a liquid environment and all connections are watertight. These transducers, these immersion transducers, they are designed to operate in a liquid environment and our connections are watertight. Okay, now immersion transducers, they usually have an impedance matching layer that helps to get more sound energy into water. Okay, and into the component being inspected. The motive is that to find out the defect from the component. Okay, so they should have a matching layer that helps to get more sound energy into the water and in turn to the component also. So immersion transducers can be purchased with a planar cylindrically focused or spherical focused lens. That depends upon the application. Now a focused transducer can improve the sensitivity and the angle resolution by concentrating the sound energy into a small area. These immersion transducers, they are typically used inside a water tank or a part of a squirter or bubbler system in scanning applications. In this way, this immersion transducer, they have their, you can say, applications, and you can say they can be used by immersing into the water, and the defects or discontinuity of the component can be find out. So in this way, these are helpful. So let's get with the MCQs. Okay. Ultrasonic testing. Detect signals produced by the transducer. The voltage produced by the transducer, which represents the signal, ultrasonic pulses are amplified. The amplified signal is available as an output for display or capture the signal processing. What do we call? We call it as a receiver. So in UT, these transducers do not contact the component. These transducers are designed to operate in a liquid environment and all connections are watertight. The just studied immersion transducer. Now in UT, this section of the instrument generates short, large amplitude electric pulse of controlled energy. Electric pulses of controlled energy, which are converted into short ultrasonic pulses when applied to an ultrasonic transducer. What do you call it? Pulsar. Okay. In UT, this displaces the air and makes it possible to get more sound energy into the test specimen so that a usable ultrasonic signal can be obtained. What do we call? Coupling. We call it as a coupling for getting the usable ultrasonic signal. Okay. Now in this testing, both the transducer and the part are immersed into the coupling, which is typically water. This method of coupling is easier to maintain consistent coupling while moving and manipulating this transducer or part. What do we call? Immersional ultrasonic testing. Very easy. So in UT, these are used for direct contact inspections and are generally hand manipulated. So they have elements protected in the rugged casing to withstand. They have elements protected in the rugged casing to withstand sliding contact with a variety of materials. I repeat, they have elements in the rugged casing to withstand sliding contact with a variety of materials. What do we call this? Contact transducer. So in UT, coupling materials of water, grease, oil or commercial materials are used to remove the air between the dash and the component being inspected. What do we call this? Between the transducer. So in UT, an attenuation of sound wave, which is the reflection of the sound in directions other than its original direction of propagation. We studied this just now. In ultrasonic testing, an attenuation of sound waves, which is the reflection of the sound in directions other than its original direction of propagation. What do we call it? Scattering. It's scattering. Okay, in ultrasonic testing and attenuation of sound waves in natural materials, however, the sound amplitude is further weakened due to scattering and absorption. Okay. Now, in UT, an attenuation of sound waves, it is the conversion of sound energy to other form of energy. What do we call absorption? So we have completed with today's lecture and MCQs, and most of the basic element of ultrasonic testing are discussed. The working principle is discussed, and the elementary diagram is also shown to you in this lecture. So if you carefully read these references also that I've shown you on the screen, you will get an in-depth knowledge of the topic that we have just discussed. Okay, now they will give you good knowledge, but also the diagrams, you will get a more elaborate diagram in these books of the various, you can say, the like the transducers that we discussed, that you will get a more elaborate diagram. Then what about the signals, the pulsers, the receivers, and you can see the, you will have the examples of waveforms. Okay, so you should consider these references and refer them to get a more, you can say, elaborative and more knowledge about this topic. So thank you all for now.